favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Make the right decision.
Welcome to special presentation with Mike and Ethan, or
Alf will not be seen tonight.
At the same time and are roughly the same age. As a matter of fact, we're now the same age again because it was just my birthday. Hello, we are now both. Wouldn't you like to know? Yes. Well, we grew up in the 80s, but at the same time, there are a lot of elements of the 80s that. That, you know, some of us got full in the face and others had just sort of slipped by. Both of us were massive fans of the comics, which is why we do this podcast. But there was something that hit me square in the face that's kind of slipped past Mike. So as a birthday gift to me, I did the Clockwork Orange thing with Mike, lubed up his eyes, and we watched some Transformers.
That's right. We saw Transformers, the cartoon series, G1, I believe. Also because we are all about adapting things into other media, we also watched Transformers the movie, 1986. So this was the adaptation of the television series cartoon to a theatrical release cartoon.
When we talked about this before, you said that you were kind of amazed that this movie got a theatrical release because it was just more of the cartoon. Do you still feel that way?
I do not. And I have
you
to
weren't.
Say, I was not prepared. I was not. So perhaps unfairly. No, I'll say this. Yeah, somewhat unfairly. I had just kind of assumed that the Transformers the movie, 1986, would basically be like, you know, Inspector Gadget the movie or Heathcliff the movie, where they just took a bunch of like episodes and squished them together and like, you know, for a cash grab. And it's not that. It is so not
they
that.
They put a lot of effort into this.
Yeah, this film is so bizarre, but it is absolutely, you can tell, they were like, this is a theatrical film, let's do something different. And they push boundaries in this that I was not expecting to see pushed. But at the same time, it definitely is... It is definitely
it's not
a product
like it's the
of
movie
its time,
from the future. It's,
you know,
even though it takes place in what was then the future, the year 2005, it is still very much a movie from 1986. It's the movie I think of when I think of the scene from Flight of the Navigator going, it's 1986, man. 8 years since that night.
the future is now.
So, Mike, you did not grow up with Transformers. You were, you know, it was probably part of the background radiation, but you didn't even, like, have any of the toys, did you?
No, I had zero Transformer toys. I was aware of Transformers because, you know, they were everywhere, you know? They were on all the TV. I remember commercials for them. I remember the TV show being on TV. On TV. Where else would you see a TV show? I think I caught, you know, a couple episodes here or there, but I had zero interest in Transformers. There were no dinosaurs on it. I know they're the Dinobots, but I tried to watch it occasionally for the Dinobots, but ultimately I was like, those aren't real dinosaurs. I don't care. I need real dinosaurs or I'm not going to watch it. So the Transformers, I understood they were very popular because, you know, all the other kids were going gaga, but it was just not something
that
ever held my interest.
That everyone else, that you say, but everyone else was into it, because it always felt to me like I was the only Transformers fan, and all my friends were into G.I. Joe.
Oh, interesting. You know, actually, now that you mention it, I of course, I didn't do a survey, you know, at the time. I had the impression that everyone was into it, but that may not have been accurate. It may be just because they were omnipresent on television. I remember the toys being around. But whether or not they were actually really popular among kids, I couldn't tell you if it was more so than, like, G.I. Joe or... I mean, I got the impression that, like, look, the big things were G.I. Joe, Transformers, My Little Pony, and Care Bears. Those are the things I remember seeing everywhere in the 80s. But I don't know how much of that is
when
due
I was
organic
big
popularity.
Care Bears too. I don't remember how I got into them, but I also remember that the very first time I saw a Transformers toy on shelves, the bears just, you know, left my mind completely. And I was like, I'm all about this now.
Interesting. So what is it about the Transformers that spoke to you so much?
You've mentioned in the past that I have a certain affinity for effigies, for, like, representations of humans that are not human, you know, like scarecrows and Jack Pumpkinheads and whatnot. That, so Transformers definitely scratches that kind of itch. I like, you know, in a lot of ways, it is anthropomorphism, but applied to vehicles rather than animals, you know, because Optimus Prime is not just, you know, he's not just a robot that can turn into a truck. You know, his whole body is his whole chest is the truck face. So it's like, he's like a superhero. He's like Truck Man. So, and he kind of has, you know, and he kind of has the personality of a wise truck driver who's seen it all. So you can, in fact, derive personality from their vehicle modes. So you have an ambulance who's an expert doctor. That's great. But you can also derive a personality by completely ignoring the personality suggested by the vehicle mode. So the ambulance is also a party animal.
which Transformer is cool but rude.
He turns into a Lamborghini, and he is a huge asshole to anyone who is less shiny than him. He's a good guy.
Is he a bad guy or a good guy?
Yeah, you know, even some of the good guys are assholes.
Does he ever have an episode where
he
learns better? Wow, I was going to say, Transformers was not one of those shows that had a moral
you know,
at the end of the episode, was it?
And then they never showed them. Yeah, there is actually,
interesting.
You can actually find that on YouTube, that there are some Transformers PSAs like G.I. Joe that was like, you know, annoying is half the battle. They even say the same thing, but... yeah, but they never got shown as part of the show. And now, because kids experience Transformers through YouTube, they don't know that.
That's, wow, what a world. That's interesting. I mean, are they made by the same animation, aren't they, as G.I. Joe?
They're made by a group called Claster or Sunbow, who are owned by Hasbro. So Hasbro, the toy makers, had their own proprietary animation studio.
And they all have that one reporter
Hector Ramirez.
Who appears
You'll
in
see
their,
him on Transformers and Gem and everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot Gem was another one that was very big at the time. Well,
absolutely.
She was more outrageous than Barbie.
Well, she is
so
outrageous as Barbie and Rockers.
Deep cut. We did watch an episode of the actual Transformers show before watching
two
the movie.
Episodes. So there were a bunch of the this is one of my favorite things is I was watching an old episode of Transformers in, you know, some 5 or 6 years ago, and my dad came in and he's like, oh, this is season two, right? I remember because it has some of the new toys. The new toys from 1985.
So that does bring up an interesting thing about Transformers that I hadn't really considered, but watching these episodes, because it's a two-parter, and the movie. So I get, every so often they introduce some new toys, and a lot of times it seems like the new toys will have, there's a new theme uniting this batch of toys, like the
Constructors. A lot of them, they have a uniting theme because they can actually combine into a big one, so you want to collect them all.
Yeah, the Constructors, they bring that up a lot, or the Constructicons, sorry, because they're all like construction vehicles, right? The kind of...
They're all construction vehicles, and they're kind of, you know, they often get fought by the Dinobots, but their real opposite number is an Autobot named Omega Supreme. You didn't see him in this. He's the biggest one of all. He turns into a into a space shuttle and tank, and, you know, basically... He's basically a small city that turns into one big robot.
Oh, wow. So the Constructicons are bad guys,
but
right?
They seem to be... Where they ally themselves with a couple of building Autobots because more than fighting, all they really want to do is build. Yeah, kind of.
So they're basically just doozers. Okay, so they're basically got different groups of, like, there's the Constructicons, there's, like, the Dinobots, there's the Insecticons, and I assume those were toys too.
You have three Decepticons who can turn into large metal insects, and then they'll also clone themselves over and over again to make swarms. The toys didn't do that.
Okay. Well, yeah, I guess that's beyond their the capabilities of 1980s toy tech. So I hadn't really thought about this, but they seem to be within the Transformers universe almost like different factions.
Yeah,
like the Dinobots, they aren't like regular Transformers. They're almost like they're freelancers or something that they bring in to help out.
Talk about how the Dinobots were actually built here on Earth. But they're not big fans of the Autobots. They're not just a special team. You may have noticed that when it's time for them to come out, they're just kind of locked in a closet or something. I like to think that they have like a playroom or something in there.
Yeah. Now, I'm going to confess that, like, I did not understand what was going on in this episode with the Dinobots. There's a lot of characters.
A butt ton
and
of characters. To...
Yeah. And it's like, look, I understand they were like, look, we need to sell these toys. You got to have all these characters appear. Because My Little Pony did the exact same thing. Worked. And, and that's the thing is, just like how when I watched My Little Pony, I was like, I don't know who any of these characters are. There's Spike the Dragon, and then just an interchangeable mess of ponies who may or may not be in other episodes, or maybe just in this one. I don't know. They're all just ponies.
Have you noticed that both the Autobots and the ponies have a friend named Spike who isn't one of them?
Oh, wow, you're right. I didn't even draw that connection, but... that is interesting. I wonder if that's just the thing, like, okay, look, we need someone that the kids can, like, remember from episode to episode. So, Spike. When I watch this episode, I'm like, look, I can't keep straight who all these robots are. They all just look like robots to me. I'm sorry, I'm a robot racist. So, robot racist. I had a lot of trouble kind of following what's going on. When the Dinobots are in dino form, I can tell them apart. But otherwise, I'm like, okay, I'm not sure exactly what's happening.
I'll lay it out for you. Maybe it'll make more sense in the context. So the Transformers, for those of you who don't know, Transformers is about alien robots who are not... They're not controlled by any kind of person. This isn't like Voltron. The robots are their own individuals. And they have come to Earth to looking for an energy resource to help power up their dead planet. But they actually crashed here 4 million years ago and were only released because of a volcano eruption, not unlike the explosion of Mount St. Helens, that revealed the spacecraft that they came from. And the spacecraft's automated defenses started rebuilding them into the forms of things that they would be able to blend in with here, not realizing that cars and trucks and planes are not the dominant species on Earth.
Huh, interesting. Well, that does explain a lot about the Transformers. That explains questions that I never knew I had, just because for years I've just accepted, oh yeah, of course they would turn into cars, why not? But it's interesting that there actually is a backstory that kind of explains all that.
And when you look at it from the perspective of someone in the early 80s, it's all very timely. They're looking for energy because there was just an energy crisis under Carter. They have a volcano in their history because of Mount St. Helens. In fact, in the comics, the volcano they live in is called Mount St. Hilary.
owned. Though that was before we had our own Mount St. Hilary here in the States.
Sir Edmund Hillary. I don't know.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, makes sense. Okay, so in this episode, what happens? The Dinobots are deserting. That much I got.
The episode is called The Desertion of the Dinobots. And it starts... I don't blame you for being confused, because this is a very confusing opening. In fact, you know, even Transformers fans are like, what the hell is happening here? Yeah, so
there's a whole lot going on.
So what we got here is some scientists who are testing this plane that they think will enable humans to not only defend themselves from the constant Decepticon energy raids, but also help defend their friends, the Autobots, too. And Optimus Prime is watching this along with them. Optimus Prime, if you don't know, is the leader of the good guys, the largest, strongest, and wisest Autobot, as they say. And nearby, we've got some other Autobots that are observing in their vehicle modes. We have Ironhide, who is Optimus Prime's best friend, the red van. And sitting in the van is Blaster, the communications expert, who is the cool guy who's all, dig it, yeah, on the case, Ace. Because it used to be now, that if you were black, they made you rhyme.
Yeah, that was a very 80s thing. I saw that a lot. Now, he turns into like a boombox, is that right? Huh. I get again that there is a toy and they're like, and probably kids are like, oh yeah, that's fun to play with, but what a shitty power in the world of Transformers. That's like getting the ring for heart, you know, like, oh, you get to turn into a boombox. But I feel like maybe I was dreaming this. There's also like an evil dog robot that turns into like a cassette tape, right?
Inexplicably, the evil Decepticon known as Soundwave is also in Ironhide. For no established reason. They're just sitting there like they're hanging out together.
Okay. And then is the evil dog,
Ravage.
Soundwave,
Ravage.
Or is he
he's
in...
actually a cat. Okay. A lot of people think he's a dog. Actually, he's a jaguar, but...
Okay. I get the impression, it seems like there's a bunch of evil robots, like some who are vaguely like human, some are a cat, one's a bird, and they basically turn into cassette tapes.
Deal. He's the communications officer for the Decepticons, and he has a number of troops of his own that he keeps in cassette form in his chest, so he can pretty much be a one-person infantry just by having them pop out of him when needed.
Okay. All right. Sorry, but like having watched this, I realized there's a lot of more, cuz I always just thought like Transformers are mostly just cars, right? I knew the Dinobots existed, but like I didn't realize that there were so many that turned into just very random things.
What Megatron transforms into?
I was extremely surprised, and I wanted to ask, is that normal? Is that what he always turns
in this
into?
Cartoon, yes. Now, kids today grew up with a version of Megatron who usually turns into a tank or sometimes a spaceship. But no, back in the 80s, he transformed into a rifle. More specifically, a pistol with a rifle stock and a silencer and a scope.
So, because I remember there's a scene where he runs into like an Autobot. He's charging the Autobots. He transforms. Somehow, the Megatron, who's big, transforms into a normal-sized gun. So he gets small, and he just falls to the ground, and another one of the Decepticons has to pick him up and fire him? Yeah, he
flip into gun mode, and Starscream caught him.
So he can't just, like, shoot when he's in gun mode. He needs other people to shoot him.
Once, but... Actually, you know who has shot him more than anyone else is Optimus Prime.
Really? There's a lot to unpack there.
They had to give him a weakness, and I think that's a good one, is that he can't fire himself.
Because most of the robots, when they turn into cars or planes or whatever, they can still fire like lasers.
And all the Decepticons can fly. So, that's the difference between them and the Autobots, at least in this show.
Oh, really? Can they turn into regular cars though?
A group called the Stunticons that they built specifically because the Autobots kept outracing them. They were like, well, we need some ground power. Let's make some cars of our own.
Okay. Transformers is very interesting in the fact that, you know, they're all robots. You know, they can all be built and repaired and all that stuff, but they're also very clearly alive.
They have personalities and they have arguments. And what I think is really interesting about Generation 1 is that the Decepticons are basically the main characters. Because they have, for one thing, there's a lot fewer of them, and the ones that you do focus on, it's mostly about Megatron, Soundwave, and Starscream. They have much more developed personalities. They're capable of a lot more subtlety. Meanwhile, the Autobots are more like the Smurfs. Each of them has like one personality trait.
I mean, I assume that that's because of that weird thing that people had kind of going into the 80s toyetic craze where they thought kids would not want to buy villains.
But all of them definitely were toys.
Yeah, because I remember like originally G.I. Joe, they were like, well, they didn't invent anyone for them to fight, which is odd. But I guess they were like, kids aren't going to buy the bad guys.
Especially the old 12-inch G.I. Joe dolls was just like that. It was G.I. Joe, a real American hero, the one that we grew up with, where they introduced Cobra and the idea that there were bad guys to fight.
Yeah. That's why they had Rocks and Bugs and Things, because no one had any villains. They're like, here's some villains you can use to fight anyone. It didn't really pan out, did it? So I guess they were right. Though honestly, I think like that's a recurring thing. It's just that villains in 80s cartoons are way more dynamic and interesting.
It's the same way with Cobra, heroes. Too.
I mean, yeah. They're all like cool. They're snake themed. They all have like wacky like quirks. G.I. Joe, they're all pretty interchangeable. All I remember is like there's Duke, there's Girl, there's. Others, I don't know
his name. The sailor guy. He's the one that Shipwreck. Yeah, he's the one everyone.
Oh,
wants.
Shipwreck.
Or at least he's the one I like. Yeah.
Yeah, Shipwreck rules. Actually, yeah, he. Yeah, that's right. He has some real personality. Yes. Thank you, Buzz Dixon.
I was going to show you a Buzz Dixon episode of Transformers, but they're even weirder than this.
Oh, really? Well, you know, when we talk to Buzz, he's definitely a guy who, you know, he really likes to go gonzo, which, you know,
he wrote the episode where a English big game hunter decides that he wants to hang the head of Optimus Prime on his wall.
That rules. That's so cool. But yeah, like all these old cartoons, you know, Care Bears, same thing. You had 100 Care Bears, and then like I don't recognize any of these guys, but Beastly and Shrieky are, they rule. They're dope. Anyway, we were speaking of Transformers. Sorry.
We have, for no apparent reason, a Autobot and a Decepticon both hanging out in an Autobot's trunk, and Ravage is deployed for some sort of mischief, and Blaster reaches out with his arm while still in his tape player mode and grabs him, and they end up in a big wrestling shoving match inside Ironhide's butt, so that's got to be fun.
Yeah, this was, I did not, yeah, I'm glad to see that it's just not me going insane, because I was just like, what is... but ultimately I think what happens is there's some sort of battle, the Dinobots get deployed, and then the Dinobots are basically like, fuck this shit,
because
we're out of here.
The whole point of this, I thought this was a good episode to show to you, because it really is kind of a day in the life for the Transformers. It's like, okay, now we're being deployed to stop the Decepticons, and we all get to show off our cool things we can do. You got to see how Jazz can do his sound and light show that confuses everybody, and how Mirage can turn invisible and just grab the cannon right off of Megatron's arm, and how Soundwave can deploy his mini-cons anytime he wants.
Yeah, I like the one... So what is it, Blaster, the one who drives Jazz in? He's like, how about some tunes?
He's the one with the voice by... He was the one voiced by Hong Jazz, Kong sorry.
So is he Scatman Crothers in the cartoon series as well as in the movie?
It was... Yes, Jazz was actually one of his very last roles. He survived in the movie because they felt it would be unfair to have to have Scatman Crothers' character die when his actor had just died. So
wait, so Scatman Crothers died just after the Transformers movie,
before Orson Welles.
Wow, that movie's got like a kill list. Yeah, jeez. But we'll get into that. So all the Transformers, as I understand, the Dinobots leave, and then the Transformers run out of energy.
We've got this. So Spike and his friends. He's with Bumblebee, as always. You probably know Bumblebee from the movies. He's a little different here because he can talk, and. It's weird. When they brought all these 80s properties back, they decided that the Kid Appeal character can't talk anymore. It happened to Battle Cat, and it happened to Snarf, and it happened to Bumblebee. Yeah.
Weird. Maybe kids like that sort of thing? I don't know.
Anyway, they go to pick up Spike's dad from the airport, and discover that there's a Decepticon base there in the form of a hangar, which says "Hangar." I thought they were masters of deception, but maybe not. So they call Prime to say, "Hey, we need someone to come help us here," and they're like, "We don't have anyone. We don't have anyone here. Oh, we'll send the Dinobots." So. They open up the door, and the Dinobots come out, and we have this great moment where Wheeljack, who is the scientist running the lab, says, "Dinobots, we need you to go down to the airport." And Grimlock, the Dinobot leader, who is of course a Tyrannosaurus Rex, says, "Me Grimlock no like follow orders." And next to him, Slag says, "Me Slag no like anything." It just sounds like he's like, "Oh yeah."
They're doing a grumpy Smurf
Slag's
thing
whole personality
there.
Personality is that he just disagrees with whatever you say.
Now, there's also Swoop, who's the pterodactyl, who seems to be. I thought Swoop was interesting because Swoop seems to be the one Dinobot who spends the most time in non-dino form.
He's not built to walk as in his Pteranodon form, so he spends a lot of time just walking with the others in his robot form. The others prefer to stay in their dinosaur forms for the most part.
There's also, a brontosaurus and a stegosaurus, but they don't seem to talk much.
And Sludge. And Sludge is the, what's his name? The voice of Scooby-Doo. Don Messick.
Don Messick doing his slow, dumb voice.
And Snarl has almost no personality whatsoever. Which is too bad for... Sorry if your favorite dinosaur is a stegosaurus, because they kind of did you dirty here.
Well, we all know that they all have brains the size of walnuts, so we wouldn't expect much. Even in Dinosaurs, that's where they were like, that's why Stego is the dumb one.
And we have... So the Dinobots get talked into it, and they go kind of grudgingly, and they, you know, completely mop the floor with the Decepticons who are attacking the airport. But then a lucky shot sets off a huge, a fuel tanker near them, and all the Dinobots get blown to smithereens, and they have to load them into a jumbo jet to carry them home. And this is about, and when you see a passenger jet and Starscream, who is about as tall as an F, Starscream is about half its height, but he transforms into an F-15. That's about when you realize scale is completely fucked with Transformers.
I did notice it was very difficult to keep, because I get that some Transformers seem to be big, like they're all bigger than humans, and then there's some that are really big, but I can't, from moment to moment and from form to form, their size really seems to vary a lot. But it's an 80s cartoon, so I wouldn't really expect, consistency. You know,
it was the best scale that Chinese unpaid Chinese prison labor could produce. So.
Now, so I have a question. So there's these kids that Transformers hang out with.
Spike.
Sam and Callie?
Spike.
Oh, Spike, sorry. Which one's Spike? Is Spike the dad or
boy. He's like 15, and his dad is Sparkplug. He's the one they went to rescue. The one they went to pick up from the airport. And if you're wondering what his real name is, we don't really know. It might be Irving. But Spike seems to be Spike's real name. And the girl is Carly. We met her earlier on. And Carly is, as you may have noticed, is a technological genius. And Spike has another friend named Chip, who is also a genius. But Spike is just some schlub.
Well, Spike is there so that we can, us dumb kids can be like, oh, he's that's
dumb
like me.
Me.
Now Spike is the one who in the movies was Shia LaBeouf, and Carly is Megan Fox.
Guess.
Is that correct? Or
I mean, they did in I think the third movie they introduced a new girlfriend. You know, they introduced a new girlfriend whose name was Carly, but she has nothing to do with this Carly. And never gets called Spike in the movie. But they are the Witwicky family. The vanishingly rare Polish name Witwicky is mostly known from Transformers.
Oh, interesting. How did they get involved with the Transformers anyway? Did they just crash land in their backyard or something?
That Sparkplug was working on an oil rig and was one of the first humans to see the Decepticons attack. And they ended up being rescued by the Autobots and kind of offered themselves as, we can vouch for these being the good guys. And so they end up kind of being ambassadors to the Transformers.
Gotcha. Okay. Makes sense. Okay. So,
the Dinobots
have defeated
but they got blown up in the process. So we see them going through the very difficult process of being rebuilt, and almost as soon as they are, then there's another call for help, and they're like, "Oh, just in time, Dinobots, get on it!" And understandably, Grimlock is like, "No, what's in this for us?" He's absolutely right.
I mean, he's got a point.
And Wheeljack is like, "Well, but you guys like to fight." And Grimlock says, "We fight when we want to."
Yeah. I mean, he's got a good point.
The thing you gotta understand about Grimlock is that he talks dumb, but he's not dumb.
Yeah, uh-huh. It's just kind of a Yoda type thing, where you just got an idiolect, I guess you could say.
Some other things, not this, but in certain comics, he's Optimus' second in command. So,
okay. So the Dinobots desert.
They commit the desertion of the Dinobots.
They disappear. Yes, and they kind of disappear for most of the rest of the cartoon until the end, but. Then everyone gets really weak because they have a weird element that they're running out of.
The Autobots try to fight the Decepticons as they raid a switching station or something, and so now we get to see another one of these battles like before, but this time nobody can do any of the special stuff you saw them doing earlier. Jazz tries to do a sound and light show, but it just comes out as static. Mirage tries to turn invisible, but he just turns black and white. And of course, one of the best lines is Megatron trying to say it's the Autobots and going, "It's the which of course is Starscream's cue to go, "Oh, too bad. He's blown his vocal circuits. I guess that makes me the new leader." It feels like he's sort of winking to the audience, like he's expecting, "Oh, he said it. He said the thing. Yay!" He said the thing. And once again, this is the part we were talking about where, even though everyone's falling apart or back and right and left, the Decepticons try to fly away, but they can't. They're, hopping and fluttering like a chicken, and they can't get up. So they all kind of, lumber away in disgrace, and that's when it's discovered that because they spent those 4 million years on Earth, this certain element called Cybertonium that they didn't realize they were so dependent on has decayed, and they're not going to be able to, retain their capacities for much longer. And... Which is when Carly is the one who points out that, wait, but there are Autobots here that aren't from Cybertron in the first place. You built the Dinobots here. They can do it. And they're like, yeah, but the Dinobots just left.
Yeah. I believe, in fact, the Dinobots go back to Cybertron, don't they?
There is a device that the Decepticons use regularly called the Space Bridge, which is basically a warp portal to Cybertron. It looks sort of like a big cake ring, but in the comics, it was a literal suspension bridge, which was pretty funny.
Now the Decepticons rule Cybertron, they're in charge, right? It seems like they're in charge over
there's
there.
Nothing all to right. be in charge of because the planet is almost dead and running on emergency power the whole time. Last episode of the show, see it restored to its former glory, and the dull gray metal all shines golden again.
Good, I'm glad to hear that. But this time, episode, we do get to see Cybertron because Spike and Carly get in a car
first they argue for the Dinobots to go and go to Cybertron to get a supply of Cybertronium that Wheeljack has back in his old lab, and the Dinobots are like, "Oh, okay, we'll just go to Cybertron. Forget that." No, they have
no loyalty with those guys.
But so they end up getting through the space ridge, which is being guarded by Devastator, who is the combined form of all of the Constructicons. Except that, because they're running out of Cybertronium, he can't pull himself together. So they manage to squeeze through.
Yeah, he's pretty useless, this guy.
So now we have part two, and it takes a very different, more human-centric turn.
Yeah, it's mostly like Spike and Carly, they meet Swoop, and they kind of wander around Cybertron, and we get to see a little of what this planet is like. They have a And I actually thought the most interesting thing was when they go into this room and they find a bunch of old-timey robots. And they say these are the ancestors of the Transformers. So the Transformers apparently like evolved from more primitive robots, which raises a lot of questions about you know, exactly
like
what's going on with
this.
Robots
build other robots. They see where to improve on the previous design a lot faster.
I mean, I guess, is it ever established with the Transformers, where do these robots ultimately, where do they come from? What started the Transformers? Do they, because they seem to exist, they live on a planet that's just mechanical. They don't have any people that built them originally. They were built by robots, but who
we'll
built those original robots,
when we get to the movie, because that actually ties into what's going on in the movie.
Oh, okay. Interesting. I think I missed a little bit of that, but now I guess we'll find out. But yeah, I didn't realize, I guess I never really thought that much about where Transformers came from. My parents never had that talk with me, so,
when a truck and a car love each other very, very much, you recline the seat back.
Now, there's also a mass transit system on Cybertron that's almost it looks like when you get on Space Mountain.
The whole thing kind of feels like Space Mountain. And also, you have a great scene with the Dinobots going through the tube just without any car, like it was Futurama.
Yeah, but... ultimately, well, what happens else on Cybertron? I'm trying to remember. I just watched this.
They find their way to Wheeljack's lab after being hunted like Tom hunting Jerry by Megatron's ally on Cybertron, whose name is Shockwave. He's the one with the single HAL eye. Yes. Which is why he talks like David Warner. And...
Oh.
Space bridge completed.
So they eventually get caught.
Yeah,
they
get caught and put in a Cybertronian mine, which I didn't realize was a thing.
Yeah, and it turns out the Dinobots are there, but they have been brainwashed because there's...
Yeah.
They did something to their circuitry or something.
A part that we saw earlier on really comes into play, because much earlier we saw Spike and Carly and Bumblebee visiting an amusement park, and they were sitting in a teacup ride, and Bumblebee's like, "What, you humans call this fun?" And Carly just opens up his chest and rewires something, and suddenly Bumblebee is laughing and shrieking like a child.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Was kind of random when that happened, but now I see the connection.
We show that Carly, being a computer genius, which, you know, Spike says, "Boy, I'm sure glad you came along here," because he's not really much good for anything in that department. She is able to rewire the Dinobots and give them their personalities back while the guards aren't looking. And so they stage a fight to get the Decepticons to open up the cage, and then there's a prison break, and the Dinobots they take Shockwave's tower again and hijack the space bridge, and everything's good from then on. But the really important thing is that along the way they watched they found their way into something like a museum that taught the history of the war and how, you know, the Autobots and Decepticons have constantly had to adapt to each other's scientific progress, and how peace never lasts under either one of them. Yeah, it really is depressing.
How depressing.
And it's like, God, this is way too this is getting way too real. And Snoop is
for
like,
real.
"Oh, I didn't know there was a reason we were fighting. I thought we were just fighting for fun."
No, now a little wiser and sadder. Swoop learn.
Yeah, it's funny.
Learns an important
Grimlock
lesson.
Is my favorite Transformer overall, but Swoop is my favorite Dinobot.
I can see that.
Well, go on.
So then, but I was going to say, so then I think they return to Earth with the Cybertonium,
and there's a big party, and Spike and Carly are given their own honorary Autobot badges. And Optimus, you know, even though Grimlock was yelling at him earlier, Optimus forgives him and is like, "You did a great job." And the Dinobots are like, "Well, we're not a big fan of taking orders, but we understand it now. So we'll listen to you until we decide we don't want to."
Well, at least they say what they they say what's on their minds.
Which is
those
usually
Dinobots.
Not that much, but it depends. Yeah, you have in the very first episode with the Dinobots, Megatron says, "So they do have weaknesses. Grimlock is arrogant, Slag is hostile, and Sludge stupid."
Is this a representative episode of Transformers, the television series?
Because there are some silly parts, the part where they're all breaking down at once, and there are some serious parts, like Swoop learning about the history, and, you know, you get some lore, and you get some callbacks to earlier stuff, and we establish the relationship between Spike and Carly. So after I had chosen this one, and then I watched it before the movie, and I was like, wow, this really is kind of the perfect one to show you what Transformers was like before the movie. Because the movie changes everything.
Right, right. Yeah, so when I watched this episode, I mean, like I said, since I don't know the robots, I had a lot of trouble following it. And so, I mean, there were parts where I was like, whoa, okay, like learning the history of the Cybertronian War, seeing the ancestral Autobots. Those were pretty interesting. But otherwise, I was kind of like, okay, here are toys for me to buy. I get it. Very 80s cartoon. And I am being unfair because, of course, you know, every 80s cartoon is like that. The only difference is some of them had dinosaurs in them, so I forgive that, you know, because, you know, it's like, oh, dino riders saucers and dino whatevers, they were all basically like, here's 100 characters that you're never going to remember, but you gotta buy the toys. After watching the Transformers episode, I was like, okay, I get it. It's pretty much what I thought Transformers was, you know, pretty close to what I'd assumed Transformers would be. And then we saw the Transformers movie. And like I said, I was not prepared. But first, I guess, you know what? We're almost at an hour. Should we
cut off?
Should we?
We're a little early, but
do our.
Sure, let's.
Should we cut and do.
Sorry, folks.
Well, do we have anything else to say about the cartoon before we get into the movie?
Is there anything that gave you any kind of thoughts?
Why does Megatron turn into a gun?
You know, I have no seriously idea what he turned into back on Cybertron, but he turns into a gun. You know, one thing about Megatron turning into a gun is that he can turn into either a Transformer scaled gun or a human scaled gun. So there is at least one episode where Megatron gets snuck into a high security place by hiding him in a guitar case.
Okay. Now, the other, you know, there's actually a few Transformers who turn into weird things. There's one,
yes,
I think it was Perceptor in this one.
Yes.
Okay. Again, very lame power, because it's like, oh, that's useful. You mean robots whose thing is to fight, and you turn into a microscope? Which, by the way, they use in a very weird ways, because like someone's hurt and uses microscope to like look at them, and it's like they're not tiny. You don't use a microscope for this. And then when he's like, ah, something's far away, I'll use my microscope to see it. It's like, that's a telescope.
It has
You're
a
using
lot of
the
uses.
Wrong tool. Yeah. But I guess, Well, I guess if you've only got a hammer, so every problem's a nail. But
the toy, in addition to robot mode and microscope mode, also had a tank mode. And he never uses the tank mode on the show.
Oh, so he actually could change its multiple things.
It wasn't a very realistic tank. It looked like a squashed microscope, but it had tank treads and everything, and he could launch stuff out of his scope. So, I guess on the cartoon they wanted to make him, less of a fighter and more of a thinker, more of a nerd.
Yeah, I got that. Like you said, they do put a lot of personality into individual robots that you can see kind of a lot of times stemming from what they turn into. And Perceptor is like, oh, I get it. He's the scientist. What kid is like, I want that one. Yeah, but Ethan, you had all of them, didn't you?
When I was a kid. Yeah.
Well, really? Oh,
up getting them because I mean these were expensive toys. These were and they broke pretty easily. They've gotten a lot better since then.
Well, I mean that's why they were like, oh, it broke, buy another one. That's how they got me with Trapasaurus, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I got an Optimus Prime, and it was already broken in the package. His legs were separated.
Wow. Ethan, how many Transformers did you have as a kid?
I had almost all of the small ones. About half of the Autobot cars, of which there were about eight. I had Optimus Prime. I had Soundwave. Mm-hmm. I did not have Megatron. I had Starscream, but neither of the other two Decepticon jets. I had Soundwave in some of the cassettes, not all of them. And I had Shockwave. And I did. Oh yes, and I did have all five of the Dinobots eventually. So yeah, I did have quite a few of them, but I definitely didn't get them all. And there are some that I'm just it's still like, oh, that's kind of my white whale. I never got that one. I always wanted this one.
I'm surprised that Megatron just didn't happen because I would assume he's a kind of an important one to get.
A realistic gun.
Oh, actually, yeah. Considering that the 80s were like, we can't have any imitatable behavior, the Transformers has, a surprising amount of violence.
Heck, it has imitatable behavior. I was always squeezing my arms and legs together to be like, I'm a car now.
I just thought it was weird because they do have that thing. Where, you know, like in G.I. Joe, they always get around the violence by saying, oh, these are robots. So when you blow up a plane and they all die, it doesn't count.
And if
they're just
robots,
a robot,
then
you know?
A parachute pops up. So the pilot survived.
Yeah, exactly. Now, it's weird in Transformers because they do the same thing, but it's like, look, these robots are all characters. They have personalities. They fear death. So when they get killed, when random robots get killed in this or blown up, it's like, it seems weird that they got away with it.
The Dinobots they're all okay in this movie, in this two-parter. And, you see the Autobots who are running out of Cybertronium sustain terrible injuries. Power Glide, the Autobot jet, is sitting there with his head in his lap.
Yeah, well, I mean, also, none of this compares at all to what happens in Transformers the movie.
Seen Transformers the movie, well, maybe you should go see Transformers the movie before you listen to our next episode.
You know what? I would recommend it because it's a thing. Like I said, I was not prepared. So, I guess.
Yeah, let's do Transformers.
Are we ready
for
Transformers
the
movie?
Next time on Special Presentation. Da-na-na-na-na.
All right, I'm going to cut right there.